Last time, we reviewed how the South Korean health and civic authorities responded to a COVID-19 outbreak in a call center in the capital city, Seoul. In the United States, the initial containment was also deemed successful, especially in light of more current research and discovery, albeit with some qualifications. And the initial U.S. effort is best discussed by reviewing a few scientific reports and articles pertaining to the first U.S. patients with laboratory-confirmed COVID-19. Starting January 20 of this year, U.S. state and local health departments, in collaboration with special divisions within the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, began contact tracing by identifying and monitoring individuals who had close contact with patients with confirmed COVID-19. They wanted to ensure rapid evaluation and care of the patients, limit further transmission, and study the risk factors for transmission. They studied closely the 10 or so of the first U.S. patients with COVID-19, all of whom were travel-related. Let us start with the following report published in the March 6, 2020 issue of the Morbidity and Mortality Weekly Report, or the MMWR, which is a weekly epidemiological digest for the United States published by the CDC. The authors are Drs. Burke and Midley of the CDC COVID-19 response team. Along with their colleagues and collaborators, they reported on 10 of the first 12 U.S. patients with COVID-19 diagnosed between January and February 2020. The many authors of this article came from the many county and state health and governmental agencies, as well as special divisions within the CDC, and attest to the coordinated effort in the containment of the initial U.S. outbreak. The article's timeline is from January 20, 2020, which was the date of the first PCR test confirmed COVID-19 in the United States, until February 26, 2020. During this period of time, the first 12 U.S. patients with COVID-19, all travel-related, were confirmed with PCR testing. However, details were discussed only on 10 patients. I inquired about the 11th and 12th patients. By direct communication via email, on May 13, 2020, Dr. Burke explained that, and I quote, "The 11th and 12th patients were unique in that they had self-identified as likely COVID-19 patients before presenting to healthcare. When these two patients arrived for testing, all healthcare staff were wearing full PPE and thus were not counted as close contacts by the local health jurisdiction. Both patients had also strictly adhered to social distancing and self-quarantine before and after diagnosis. For this reason, they had no community close contacts either." Unquote. However, for this presentation, I am placing a cloud diagram behind these two patients because we really don't have any formal investigation into these cases. During my email correspondence with Dr. Burke inquiring more details about her MMWR report, she referred me to a preprint manuscript that she and her colleagues had submitted for publication. It has been available online since May 3rd, but is not yet peer-reviewed. In this preprint manuscript, Dr. Burke and colleagues detailed the contact tracing and management of 9 of the 10 first U.S. travel-related COVID-19 cases. Since she and her collaborators described 10 patients in their MMWR report, but the preprint manuscript only detailed 9, Dr. Burke clarified via email that, and I quote, "The 10th patient was reported in the MMWR but not in the preprint. This is because the local health jurisdiction for that patient did not participate in an enhanced contact tracing investigation. They did conduct active monitoring and tested any contacts that became symptomatic, but they did not test any asymptomatic close contacts, nor did they collect detailed questionnaire data on close contacts." Unquote. And thus, I am placing a cloud diagram on this patient as well for the purpose of this presentation because I don't have any formal report about this case. One of the 9 cases discussed by Dr. Burke and collaborators was actually investigated earlier in detail by another investigative team at the CDC and dealt with the first known person-to-person transmission of COVID-19. Or in other words, one of the infected patients investigated was not travel-related, but became infected due to close contact with a travel-related infected patient. This report was in the April 4 issue of the scientific journal The Lancet, but available online since March 12, 2020, written by Drs. Isaac Gunai and Tristan McPherson of the Epidemic Intelligence Service Division at the CDC and their colleagues. And thus, we will be discussing the U.S. effort to contain the initial COVID-19 outbreak related to these 9 patients by studying the scientific report and article. Let's turn our attention first to The Lancet article. It details the COVID-19 transmission from a travel-related patient in Illinois to a spouse in the last few weeks of January 2020. This was the first known case of person-to-person transmission of COVID-19 in the United States. Both Illinois patients had mild to moderate illnesses that started with nonspecific symptoms, making early identification difficult for patients, clinicians, and public health investigators. The second patient in this report, who is the spouse of the original test-positive travel-related patient, had a baseline cough and dyspnea that made identifying new symptoms challenging. Together, patients 1 and 2 of this report had 372 contacts, but unfortunately, 25 of those contacts were not actively monitored due to insufficient contact information. And thus, I will also put this group along with a cloud diagram. Of note is that the author stated that none of the individuals were found to have emergency department visits with fever, cough, or shortness of breath for 14 days after the last exposure, based on the near real-time surveillance data received from regional acute care hospitals. This, I surmise, is a way to reassure the readers that even though there weren't enough data for active monitoring, there is evidently no symptoms suspicious for COVID-19 in this group of 25 contacts. We are left with 347 contacts who were assessed for risk of COVID-19 transmission and were actively monitored for development of symptoms. Active symptom monitoring was done using a software called Research Electronic Data Capture. Contacts received automated, twice-daily emails inquiring about symptoms, including cough and shortness of breath, as well as a request for self-measured temperature. If symptoms or fever were reported, or if contacts did not respond or decline email monitoring, then public health officials would telephone the contacts daily. Of the 347 contacts, 195, or 50% of whom, were healthcare personnel, or HCP, and 152 were community members. Of these, 119 had exposures classified as medium risk to high risk, although the majority of the monitored contacts had low-risk exposures, 228 of 347, or 66%. Let's take a closer look at the 195 contacts who were healthcare personnel. To identify possible exposure in healthcare personnel, patient logs and staffing records were obtained and reviewed for all healthcare settings visited by patients with COVID-19. Security footage was reviewed to identify additional healthcare personnel and patients who had contact with patients with COVID-19 during transport through the admitting hospital. All healthcare personnel contacts were offered testing, but the authors disclosed that laboratory capacity and availability of healthcare personnel to undergo testing were limited, quote, in the setting of this urgent investigation, unquote. How were the risk stratification done? Or how did the authors classify low, medium, or high risk? High-risk healthcare personnel were ones who were performing or being present in the room during a procedure that is likely to generate higher amounts of respiratory secretions or aerosols, while not using all recommended PPE or personal protective equipment. Or healthcare personnel in close contact while not wearing respiratory protection with COVID-19 test positive patient who is also not wearing a face mask. Medium high risk is defined as a duration of contact of 15 minutes or more with test positive patients or their secretions or excretions while not using all recommended PPE. Medium risk is more than a brief 1 to 2 minutes contact with test positive patients or their secretions or excretions while not using all recommended PPE, and that does not meet the definition of either a high risk or a medium high risk. Low risk is any duration of contact with test positive patient while using all recommended PPE. Healthcare personnel who had a brief 1 to 2 minute interaction with a patient but not involved direct contact while not using all recommended PPE. Or working at the same time and location as a test-positive patient, but unsure whether they were in the same room. And by the way, just walking by a test-positive patient in a corridor is not considered a close contact. Although the investigators broke down the close contact into subgroups for more detailed analysis, for the purpose of this presentation, I am regrouping them into the 347 close contacts who underwent active monitoring. Of these, 43 were considered PUI and 303 were not. PUI again stands for person or patient under investigation. The definition of PUI during the initial phase of the U.S. outbreak was unfortunately quite narrow, but reportedly is the standard case designation used by the CDC during an outbreak. In this particular report, PUI is defined as any contact who developed fever, cough, or shortness of breath during active monitoring. Those contacts who were classified as PUI were isolated and tested for SARS-CoV-2. Out of the 43 PUI, 32 of them were healthcare personnel and 11 were community members. None tested positive for SARS-CoV-2. Of the 303 contacts who were not considered PUI, the investigators also decided to look further into 32 who were healthcare personnel by administering a one-time nasopharyngeal or oropharyngeal swab test. None tested positive for SARS-CoV-2. The investigators observed that the experience of limited transmission of SARS-CoV-2 in this case is different from that documented in Wuhan, where transmission has been reported to occur across the wider community and in healthcare personnel. The authors offered that limited transmission described here could be related to the severity of illness, the extent of viral shedding, and the timing of exposures to a symptomatic patient. Also, infection control measures within the hospital setting and an aggressive public health response might also have prevented further exposures. In conclusion, the authors noted that the absence of COVID-19 transmission among healthcare personnel supports these recommendations regarding appropriate infection control. These findings also support CDC's assessment that, without using appropriate PPE, the people living in the same household or providing care in a non-healthcare setting for a symptomatic COVID-19 test-positive patient will have high-risk exposure. CDC's recommendation for people with high-risk exposures to remain quarantined with no public activities might be effective in reducing onward person-to-person transmission of SARS-CoV-2. As for limitations, the investigators pointed out that this report pertains only to one case patient with only one known transmission. They may not have identified all possible contacts. And this being the first person-to-person transmission in the United States, that their study was performed before formal CDC guidelines for classifying exposure risk. The difference in risk stratification with later CDC guideline limits usefulness of this study if directly compared with later studies. The nasopharyngeal and oropharyngeal specimens obtained from both the PUIs as well as the non-symptomatic healthcare personnel were one-time rather than serial testing during the 14-day observation period. The 32 healthcare personnel who did not have symptoms but who were selected for nasopharyngeal and oropharyngeal testing were convenience sample, which literally means sampling out of convenience. A type of sampling method taken from a group of people who just happen to be easy to reach, simply because they are available and are willing to participate. Asking willing people to answer some survey at a mall or a grocery store would be an example of convenience sampling. However, these 32 healthcare personnel were indeed chosen because they were of higher risk. Finally, active symptom monitoring by definition will miss asymptomatic transmission or infection, which we have since learned from other subsequent studies that this indeed can occur. Let us now go back to the 9 patients reported by Dr. Rachel Burke and her colleagues. These 9 patients were among the first U.S. patients who were tested positive for COVID-19, and all were travel-related. The report details the investigation of the 553 close contacts of these patients. I would like to re-emphasize that this manuscript that we will be reviewing is still in the preprint stage, which means that it has not been reviewed by scientist peers of Dr. Burke. The many authors of this manuscript come broadly from across the many states and jurisdictions involved, as well as special investigative teams from the CDC. What were the authors looking for when investigating potential exposure? They wanted to determine, first of all, whether the persons meet the definition of close contact, and if so, whether they met the criteria for active monitoring, and what risk level were the exposures. Individuals not meeting the definition of a close contact are not included in this report. 404 people were found to meet the criteria for active monitoring, while 149 were not actively monitored. For active monitoring, unfortunately, there was non-uniformity. Some sites were able to collect information on all close contacts, while other sites collected information only on those close contacts they classified as having had high risk or medium risk exposure. However, most sites chose to actively monitor those with medium risk or higher exposures. The risk stratification or definition of low, medium, and high risk also varied by site, but all sites classified household contacts as well as healthcare personnel who provided patient care without all recommended PPE as high risk exposure, and any community contact spending more than a brief 1 or 2 minutes closely interacting within 6 feet of a test positive patient, such as sharing a meal, a car ride, or seated within a few seats on the plane. The presumed infectious period also varied by site. In one site, the presumed infectious period began on the date of symptom onset of the travel-related test-positive patient, while in other sites, the investigators also considered between 1 and 3 days before symptom onset of the travel-related test-positive patient. Why were some contacts not monitored? Well, they can be considered to have had low-risk exposure and therefore not meeting the active monitoring criteria, or they were considered, quote, out of jurisdiction, unquote, or simply, they could not be contacted. Those who did not meet the criteria for active monitoring, but who could be contacted, were asked to self-monitor and to contact the local health department should they develop symptoms. Because these 149 were not actively monitored, I chose for the purpose of this presentation to place a cloud diagram over this group since we have no additional information about them. At this point, the investigators further subdivide the 404 who met the criteria for active monitoring further into 66 of those who were monitored but offered no additional exposure information, and the remaining 338 close contacts who were actively monitored and who had more detailed exposure information. The active monitoring was done by daily communication via phone, text message, email, and in person, and the close contact individuals were asked to report temperature and any symptoms. The 338 contacts were identified and further subdivided as follows. There were 15 household members, 163 healthcare personnel, and 160 community members, 95 of whom were considered exposed in a healthcare setting, such as in an ER or urgent care or a clinic waiting room, and 65 contacts in the community at large. Of the 163 healthcare personnel who were monitored, 126 were found to have detailed information to describe the nature of patient contact as well as the usage of personal protective equipment, or PPE. 24 of the 95 community members who were exposed in a healthcare setting and 54 of the 65 community members at large had sufficient information to detail and classify the specific type of exposure. And these details include information such as whether there was face-to-face contact with the test-positive patients and for how long, whether there was direct contact with the patients, whether being within 6 feet of the patients, and whether patients were coughing during that time, whether they took an object from the patient, rode in the same vehicle and being within 6 feet of the patient, and being in the same room as patients and for how long. Of note is among the community contacts at large, the authors had investigated 17 workplace close contacts, 17 airport quarantine station screeners, 13 close contacts on airplanes, 4 rideshare drivers, and 3 friends. The flight-related contacts were defined as passengers who were seated in the same row or 2 rows in front of or behind the case patient. Of the 126 healthcare personnel who were monitored with more information, the authors went further into details about the types of precautions that were taken by the healthcare personnel during certain procedures that could have caused droplets or aerosolization by the test-positive patients, the handling and processing of infectious fluids obtained from the patient, and the use of PPE. And if no full PPE was used, what would be missing? For example, no gown, no gloves, no eye protection, face mask only, ill-fitting face masks, etc. For the purpose of this presentation, however, I will summarize the author's findings in this table. The yellow section is the household contacts. There are 15 of those. The blue section will detail the 163 healthcare personnel. And the green section combines the community members who were exposed, whether in the healthcare setting or at large, into one group of 160 individuals. We will first consider who among these developed some symptoms that were considered suspicious for COVID-19. All of these people were tested. There were 16 symptomatic community members, 25 healthcare personnel, and 8 household members, totaling 49, all were tested for COVID-19. The remainder did not show any symptoms for the duration of the observation. Let's just fill in those numbers into the table. Some in this group got tested even though they were asymptomatic. Among these asymptomatic who were tested were 51 of the community members, 52 of the healthcare personnel, and the remaining 7 of the 15 household members, or a total of 110 asymptomatic individuals were tested, in addition to all the symptomatic individuals. The remainder, non-symptomatic, were not tested. Reviewing the house contact in the yellow section in further detail, of the 15, 8 had some symptoms suspicious for COVID-19 during the period of observation, and the remaining 7 were asymptomatic during this time. All 15 were tested with at least one set of respiratory sample. Only 2 people were tested positive for SARS-CoV-2. Both are spouses of respective patients. The remaining 13, including 7 remaining spouses of respective patients who either maintain separate living quarters or maintain strict isolation if cohabiting, all tested negative by serial respiratory samples. Of the blue healthcare personnel group and the green community contacts group, whether they were tested because they had shown some symptoms that were suspicious for COVID-19 or simply were chosen for testing despite having no symptoms, all of those who were tested were negative. The authors concluded that the household members of test-positive patients, especially spouses or significant others, are at excess risk of contracting COVID-19. Lack of observed secondary transmission to healthcare personnel attests to the importance and effectiveness of rapid identification and isolation of suspected cases of COVID-19 and the appropriate use of PPE in caring for these patients. They also observed that most, if not all, of these first travel-related cases were likely cognizant of the possibility that they were infected and engaged early in preventive practices such as wearing face masks, practicing social distancing, and seeking medical attention, and that these practices may have contributed to reducing secondary transmission of COVID-19 in this population. Especially with regards to household members, adhering to home isolation precautions and with careful monitoring may have helped to stop the infection spread. The investigators also acknowledged several limitations to their study. Although the many different sites across the many states involved tried to standardize the data for the purpose of analysis, there were non-uniform guidelines and inconsistencies in certain aspects of contact tracing and data collecting. Different teams made different decisions regarding how to define close contacts, which close contacts to actively monitor, how to categorize exposure risk, which types of exposure information to collect, and how often and from whom to attempt collection of respiratory samples. Most notably, not all contacts were tested, in part because the working definition of person or patient under investigation, or PUI, at the time of the investigation was quite restricted. Many exposures were also outside of the reach of the investigating teams and therefore were simply not included in the investigation. All this non-uniformity and inconsistency led to incomplete and missing data, which in turn may have accounted for the low secondary attack rate. Out of the many hundred contacts of the 9 patients in the study, only 2 spouses were tested positive for COVID-19 from person-to-person transmission. Secondly, since only selected individuals in the total contact pool were tested, individuals who were indeed infected but showing no symptoms, or possibly showing symptoms much later, would not be detected in this study. In the next and last video of this series, we will revisit the timeline of the first 6 weeks or so of the COVID-19 outbreak in the United States, and we will explore how the fascinating field of genomic epidemiology is able to piece together probably the most accurate picture of the spread of SARS-CoV-2 in this pandemic, both in detailed and big picture approach.